Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Talking Football podcast. I'm delighted to say we're joined on the line this week by former Hibs star Stephen Tico. Stephen, thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you for letting me on. Thank you for the message you sent me on social media, because it's always nice to be able to talk about my life, career, and football. So thank you from myself.
Yeah, it's what a career you've had, Stephen, as well. It's very unorthodox. You've been absolutely everywhere, pretty much across the globe. You're in Lithuania just now. We're just speaking off air. What's it like over there with regards to living, of course, with the coronavirus? Have you been affected by it?
Last year, yes, because after the first game of the season, we had to stop for 3 months, I think, something like that. So, like I was telling you previously, I was by myself at the time. So, new country, new everything, new start. And that coronavirus arrived and I was like, wow, what am I going to do right now? I was grateful though, because I was thinking and telling myself, well, I did sign the contract on time, because it could have been a disaster. You know, I've been telling friends and family that maybe a few days later, it could have been maybe the end of my career. Wow. Not because I would have want to, but with the COVID situation, you understand?
Yeah.
So I was grateful, and now we are back to normal almost. The restaurant's gonna, some are reopened already.
Yeah.
We don't have to wear the mask when we're outside walking. We just need to wear the mask when we're going to do a grocery shop, shopping mall, and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But it's nothing like Paris or Edinburgh, for example.
Yeah. Talking about Paris, then, of course, you were born there and back in February 1987. Growing up, was it Saint-Denis around about where you grew up, Stephen?
Yeah, not far from Saint-Denis. Yeah, not far from Saint-Denis. Like, I'm from Pantin, and Pantin is in the Saint-Denis district, Saint-Denis district.
What was that like growing up? Were you always playing football, always kicking a ball around?
Yeah, I can't remember when, but like since the very beginning, I had that passion, and I've been telling everyone that I would like to become a football player. And I remember at the time, you know, at school, at kindergarten and stuff, no, this is not a job. And then the following year, they were asking me, you know, back in the days, you had to write on a paper what you want to become. Yeah. And every year it was the same. And then I was like, you can tell me whatever you want. This is what I want to do, you know. And obviously I had the chance and the luck to have like my parents. That's been like, they told me one day, okay, you've been saying this for the last 4 or 5 years. So if you want to do this, we're going to support you in order to make it. And now it's been, I'm professional since I'm 18 and I just turned 34. So yeah. It's very nice.
Yeah, absolutely. Was PSG the team you supported as a boy?
No, to be fair, I didn't support PSG. I don't know why, but, you know, I was watching every football team.
Yeah.
But I never had... I never had that strong connection with PSG since I was a boy.
Yeah.
But I had my times where, you know, my passion was like growing, and then some moment as well that I was like, oh no, I don't know if like the way they are, if it's really the way I am. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to be in front of you tonight and tell you, yeah, no, I've been a PhD fan from day one. No, that would be a lie, and yeah. I'm not like this. But, you know, I'm proud to be from Paris, obviously. I'm following them, and I wish that they can do well, but I'm not like some guys that who are from Paris like me, you know, who tell you now from day one I've been a PSG fan.
You would have been 11 when the World Cup was on in France. What's your memories of that? Can you remember much about
Yeah, of course. I remember, like, I was, you don't know, like, you're talking up to a crazy, crazy fan of football.
that?
So, believe me, I remember that World Cup like it was yesterday. Unbelievable memory because, first of all, I'm a football fan. It was in my country. Like, you were like, I remember myself, like, trying to do everything to watch as many games as I could, you know. The first one was Scotland against Brazil. And yeah, the final, the craziness of the country after the last whistle and stuff like that. I was on holiday with my family in the south of France. My dad took us out and so it was so nice. Very, very nice memory.
Did you have any heroes watching that team? Any players that you wanted to be like?
To be honest, not really. But after when I grew up, I was enjoying watching Lilian Thuram a lot because he was a player who could play almost everywhere. Then I'm from Guadeloupe like him, so you know it was all of those things, and people were making a comparison with Marcel Desailly as well. But yeah, I would go for Lilian Thuram.
Being from Guadeloupe, would you know Michel-Antoine Currier? Would you know who he is at all?
I do. I was on the phone with Mikael
Were
last week, and we are messaging almost every day, but over the phone, we were on the phone last
you?
week. Yeah, I do know who he is. Yeah.
He's a top guy. We had him on. I had him on last year. He's full of life, that guy, isn't he? He's a great character.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he's full of life. That's Mikael. You know, it's you either like him or hate him, but like you know, he's like that, like full of energy, dead cheesy, really nice guy.
Yeah, he certainly is. What was it? Where did you go as a youngster, Stephen? Was it the Clairefontaine, or did you go to Nantes first?
No, I went to Clairefontaine at age 13. Yeah.
What
That
was
was
that? What was that like?
the best 3 years of my life. Like every time people are asking me about Clairefontaine, I can talk to you about it, but you won't get it. You need to go there. You know what I mean? Like you need to have what I did have during those 3 years. You know, first of all, at the time it was like without any doubt the actual best place in football, you know, for youngsters in the world. I'm not talking only about France. The coaches were the best. They made before me us Thierry Henry, Nicolas Anelka. So, you know, when you get Luisa, when you get to a place like this and you're 13 and these guys are talking to you, are giving you advice and stuff, you can just listen. You know what I mean? Sometimes I know because I've been there, and I'm not saying that it's right, but you can maybe get to work with a coach, but you know his name to you is not like doesn't represent that thing, you know what I mean? So I'm not saying that there is coach that I haven't listened more than others, no, but you know the impact on myself were different with some coaches, that's for sure, you know, because of what they have done, what they have achieved, and the way they were talking to you, the small details, you know. And now that I'm 34, I'm like, wow, these guys were already in the future, but it's not like I was doubting it. No, because I knew. But the more you grow and you are still in that game and you're like, wow, like that coach told me this 20 years ago and I'm still doing this and it's still working, you know? And
yeah.
You're like, wow, it's advice that can make you last in that football game that's getting more and more difficult, by the way.
Yeah. Did you have to move away then as a young boy to the academy?
Yeah. From age 13, I received the letter to tell me that I was getting to the academy, and it was finished. No mom and dad, no brothers.
Yeah.
I just had my little one who just arrived in 1999, and after a few months of life together, I was going to the academy from Sunday night till Friday night. So
oh.
I just had, yeah. So my mom was like, are you gonna be okay? And I was like, mom, I'm gonna be more than okay. You're gonna be, because this is what I wanted, you know?
Yeah.
And she obviously didn't tell me for a few months, but like my mom was crying when she was coming back from work, because I'm so close and to her. And then when you've got your 13 years old kid, it doesn't matter the distance, you know, but like who's not sleeping, you're coming back from work every day, you're not seeing your kid, you know, it's very sad and hurtful. But after that, you know, she could see me like coming back and very happy and stuff like that. And I think this put on her mind that now he's okay over there and he's very happy. This is what he wants to do. So after that, it was okay. But yeah, I left my family, friends, and neighborhood at age 13.
Yeah. From there, did you go to Nantes from there? Is that how it works? They sort of try and fix you up with a club?
Yeah, because Clairefontaine is a pre-academy,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And after that, at the time, the best one were staying there 3 years. The better one, sorry, were staying there 3 years, which I did. And after that, after the third year, you have to go to an academy.
Yeah.
And I decided to sign and to go to Nantes, yes.
Yeah. I've heard that we had Armand Doni on a wee while ago. He went to Nantes and he says it was the best time of his life there in terms of, he says it was so much fun. He maybe had too much fun and he took his eye off the ball a bit and he was released eventually. How did you find the academy there?
It was nice, but it was below Clairefontaine.
Yeah.
Yeah, like once more, you know, it's not like to people sometimes, ah, no, your love with Clairefontaine. I say, no, guys, believe me, like if you had the chance to go there for 3 years, you can go wherever you want. Like you're not gonna find what we had in terms of football pitches, food, nutrition, coaches, you know.
Yes.
So not was good, but already when I get there, I had, without telling them, you know, that issue with coaches, because some of the coaches were, I don't know, 20 something.
Yeah.
And I've just spent 3 years at Clairefontaine with coaches who were like 50s and stuff, yeah, like that, with what I explained you 10 minutes ago, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was like, what? This coach is telling me that this is not right, but I've got that coach who made that player, yeah, who's been telling me that this, you know what I mean? And I was, yeah, like, no, this is what you're telling me is not right, you know? And because Clairefontaine at the time was better than, even if it's a pre-academy, was better than all the academies, you know, in terms,
wow,
of in terms of football,
yeah,
you know, of,
yeah,
football. So sometimes, you know, the arguments were coming, oh, you think you're still at Clairefontaine, and I was like, no, but
expect better.
you signed me with my quality, with everything. I'm not going to change because it's like I'm talking to you right now, Derek, and you've been working I don't, for 3 years and somewhere, and you come to my work. That is, it's the same as yours, right? And I'm telling you, no, Derek, you have to do this, and you're no, Steven. I know what I'm doing, you know. So, and like you said, I was expecting the standard to be way higher. And I remember myself phoning my big brother, and I was like, but some of the guys here, I don't know what they are doing here, you know, like, and it wasn't being a big head or whatsoever, you know. It was just because I've been here at Clairefontaine, but I was young, it's 13 till 16. So I was like, the next step, the standard should go even higher, you know. The coaches were like, yeah, we had issues. I'm not gonna, we had issues in terms of, yeah, Steven, you need to play 100% because the time, by the time you go with the older guy, it's gonna be difficult. And I was like, so it means that you don't know who you did sign. And then, you know, when a 16 years old is telling you this the way I just did to you, like, instead of being like, oh, this guy is confident, it was like, this guy is arrogant, you know. And I was like, why am I arrogant if I know what I'm capable of? I know my strength, I know my weakness. I'm not telling you that I'm the best in the world, but I'm arrogant. And between us, Derek, if you want to make it in that job, if you don't have these things that call confidence, just quit. Just quit. It's simple as that. If you go to a changing room and you're like, oh, this guy is better than me, or don't even start, because the guy's gonna eat you, you know. And then I proved them wrong, by the way. Every time they were putting me with the oldest guy, I was getting to the team, never quit, never quit. We were winning and everything. So then at the end, they are like, oh wow, oh, we've got someone here, you know. And I wanted to be like, you put me for 6 months with the guy of my age, but you have to know, in France, when you're from Paris, Paris is the strongest place with the best player of France, you know. So if you are one of the best from that particular place, it means that your level is very high, right? And Nantes is obviously not in Paris. And so I was like, yeah, this prove you that, you know, I wasn't arrogant. I knew that I could do more, but I just keeping some qualities and stuff because I didn't have to show them at the time, you know. But for them, like, and then, you know, for me, they didn't try to understand the person before the player to start with, to know how I was thinking, because, you know, that's the thing when you're from an academy and you go when from a pre-academy, when you go to an academy, because the rest of my teammates at Nantes were there since they were 13, you understand? So they saw them grow up from very young kids to like youth adults. But me, I arrived and I was already 16 with my past and this and that. I was already in national team. So sometimes, you know, it can get a bit confusing because there is not enough communication. But it was nice, but yeah, once more, not as nice as Clairefontaine, for sure.
You said the national team. Before we talk about the 2004 Euros, were you playing for France before that tournament, Stephen, then?
Yeah. I It's nice that you're asking me the question because sometimes I'm reading like interviews and stuff, and people are writing everything and they don't know. So, just for you, the first cap ever of my national team, 87, I was already there. It was against Spain. There was myself, there was Samir Nasri, there was Benoît Costil, and then we've been there for 4 years. So, the first International Cup of the team 1987, I was there, and a few, we were more than a few that's been, we stayed the 4 years, you know. But yeah, under 16, we were under 17, under 18, under 19, we were together, and then it's the playing for our, representing your countries. There is no words for that.
Not just that, I mean, you were captain as well. What was that like, having that honor?
If people are gonna maybe think that I'm crazy, but over, it was great, very nice. But I've been captain almost everywhere in my career, you know. So I'm not gonna lie, with the new coach Philippe Bergerot, that's been a mentor to me and that I love and respect so much. When he took over at the end of the under 16 years, he was passing the captain armband every games to a new players, right? He's the first one who put me captain, first one. And when we arrived at the Euro first game against Northern Ireland, he showed a paper board, and then next to my name it was like captain, and I was like, oh, probably it's gonna, you know, change every game. Second game captain, third captain, and then I was his captain for the last 3 years. So it was great. And I don't know if you know, but a journalist made a book about my team, my
Yeah, I've
Genesis
seen it,
team.
yeah.
Yeah, and obviously with us the player, not with what journalist, where, you know, which is the best way. And the coach say, for me it was normal to give the armband to Steven because he was the natural leader of the team, you know. He knew when to say, hey guys, wake up, when it was good, you know what I mean. And I always got that in me, even here in Lithuania. Some of the young guys, sorry, are telling me, for me you're the captain of the team, even if you don't have the armband, you know, the way you talk. And actually last game, like last Saturday after the game, a few people translated to me, and the journalist was like, Steven Tiku is like a dad on the field for the guys. And the coach was like, no, Steven got this in him, you know, like talking when it's good, when it's not good. And because football is everything to him, so yeah, it was an honor. And obviously by being captain with the national team means that I touched the trophy the first and stuff like that, you know. It's things that you keep with you forever, you know.
Of course, you beat Portugal in the semis and then Spain in the final. Can you remember much about the final and winning and holding the trophy and things like that? It must have been an amazing experience.
Yeah, it was great. The first time I rewatched every game was last year. Since yeah, and I was like, wow. Like sometimes I was like, I had a great tournament. I was obviously like focusing on myself, and I'm like, wow, you had a great tournament. And the final, obviously, when we scored, when Samir scored towards the end and stuff, and you know that there is a few minutes to go and you're winning. And then, like, we were home, all the players that, you know, friends, families, people from our areas, neighborhoods. So, you know, it's something special, you know. You Words can't describe the feeling. And by touching the trophy, because before us, no French team ever won that under 17. Many reached the final, but they got beaten, you know. So, you know, it was like when we reached the final, we were happy, but we were like, oh, we don't want to be like, you know, the other ones who's been that close. And, you know, so when we won, we were like, oh, we did it, and it was great.
What was the success down? Was it like you say, Philippe Bergeroud? Do you think it's a lot down to the coach that you won that tournament, or the great players that you played alongside?
Tell me that again, sorry.
Sorry, yeah, was it a lot down to the coach Philippe Bergeroud, and you had some, yeah.
The coach has been a big part of it.
Yeah.
Like in terms of tactic, believe me, the 4-4-2 of the coach, until now, I can tell you every session, Derek, we were working. He was taking his paperboard, and then so you see, when the ball is here, you go there, you go there, you start the pressing, and you know, when you're young, sometimes you know, okay, you're not saying out loud, you know, yeah, but come on, coach, we know that by now, you know, we were getting to the pitch, no need to speak.
Wow.
That guy was making the first move. Boom, 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 boom. We were getting the ball back. After that, play, pass. And it was like, and you know, it's those little things that when you manage to have coaches like that at your young age, that showed you that hard work, dedication, repeating the same things over and over can work. And after that, you sign professional and you get coaches that you want to talk tactic with them. And you can see that in a tactical way, they are not that good. And you're like, but what is wrong? You know what I mean? I've been at age 17 with somebody who made me love tactic, the pressing and stuff like that. And I'm now professional. And we are not talking about this because many times as a central defender, I like to say to my coaches or to the teammates, I don't think we're that good to press. And they're like, really? Why are you thinking that? I say, because pressing means that we need to get the ball back. Press doesn't mean running just to run and lose energy, you know? And yeah, but why, what would you change? And I said, we need to change something. Because I've been with coaches before that pressing means after three or four passes, five max, we were getting the ball back. So we have some things to change. It could be desire, the speed, the mentality, you know. And after that, some players are thinking a few days, watching a few games on TV, oh, Steven, you are right. And I'm like, but I know, you know. Because, like, I had the luck to been with these guys, and people don't know Philippe Bergeau was in the World Cup 98 squad as a goalkeeper coach. You know what I mean? So we're not talking about small people who doesn't know anything about the game, you know, yeah, he's 4-4-2. Like sometimes we were even like taking the piece in front of him, and he was laughing because like he was when we won, he was like, "You see, guys, every day, but look, my 4-4-2 things." And we were like, "Coach, honestly, sometimes it was annoying, but thank you so much."
See the players you played with there. You mentioned Samir Nasri, of course. Hatem Ben Arfa played, and Karim Benzema. I heard a story that he worked really, really hard on his game, but back in the day, what were these guys like to play with?
It was easy. It was easy. Like they told you that it was easy to play with me as well. You know, because many times people, especially in my country, when you read everything, it's like four players only won the tournament, you know, which for me is disrespectful for the rest of the squad. because at the time, to start with, Karim wasn't even playing, you know?
Wow, yeah.
So, but because he's now a top player in Real Madrid and unbelievable and everything, to make the things better, oh yeah, the four players, the four stars. And I'm like, Karim himself will tell you that he was on the bench. He played 15 minutes that tournament. The whole
wow,
tournament.
Really?
15. Wow. 15, Derek. Jeez. But in that 15 minutes, he scored one goal, the first goal of the tournament against Northern Ireland. We couldn't score. I don't know if it was the pressure and blah, blah, blah. He got on, what a goal he scored. And after that, he didn't even play anymore, you know? Wow. But it was to come back to your question, it was easy for few reasons. First of all of those guys are football lovers like me.
Yeah.
I don't think if France had a generation of players that love football that much, like, you know, we were having competition about everything to see the one who knows the most player and, you know, oh, this guy played where, how did he score? You know, it was crazy because back in the day, we started football for total different reasons than the boys right now.
Yeah.
It was for the love for the game. You know, we didn't know how much money was getting Zidane, or, you know, we didn't know. And it wasn't even our problem or issue. Now, kids are starting football for those things.
Yeah.
Because those things are in the media, Instagram, this, that. You know what I mean? A few still do it for the love of the game. But now you can buy a kid who's just 8 years old, 10 years old. 1 million. Are you having a laugh? You know? So it's different. And the second thing is that we had the same football view in terms of intelligence. He was making the move. He knew the ball was going to arrive. You know, that connection that you're like, wow, it was so nice. And I've said many times when we were going to national team for a week or 10 days, the level was sometimes as high as a first team. First team players, you know what I mean? Because it was everyone at the time were like at the top of his game as a youngster, and it was so nice to watch.
Yeah.
So nice to watch.
Yeah.
So that's the two things for me that made us the way we were.
Yeah. When you won that tournament, Stephen, I'd imagine there'd have been a lot of clubs that were watching that and maybe watching you. Did you have any offers from any clubs after that?
You know what, Derek? Football is a crazy world. And I found out a lot of things when I joined Hibs. Mm. So when I joined Hibs, the scout who made me join Hibs is called David Fouquet, right? He phoned me. I was unemployed after the end of my contract with Nantes. And he said, hi, Steven, my name is David Fouquet. I used to be the scout of Chelsea and I wanted you when I was working there. I was on the phone, I swear. I was like, stop this. You know, I say, stop this. And then he was like, excuse me. And then I got that it was serious, you know. And then he was like, now I'm working for Hibs. Would you want to come here and stuff like that? And I was like, well, my dad always told me you cannot say no if you don't go and see from your own eyes. So no, I'm up for it, you know?
Yeah.
So when I arrived there and stuff, David explained me everything. Yes, we found Nantes. I was working at Chelsea at the time. They asked us for crazy amount of money. I said, I never heard about it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I said, how this can even be possible? And he says, Steven, I swear. And then he say, he's been honest. It wasn't the Chelsea of Abramovich. We didn't have. So when we heard the money they were asking us, we said, no, okay, we just leave him, you know? But he said, if you're here with me, it's because I know you since you're a youngster. Because Hibs, for me, means 21 years old. The guy saw me at the under 17 or 16, you know, since I was in national team. So, and I had also an agent at the time who, I'm just gonna be nice and quick on that part, like,
No good.
yeah. And after the tournament, we went with my family and we said, so tell us what are the clubs that want Steven after the tournament? And he say, nobody. And my dad was like,
No
no,
way.
you must be kidding. Player of the, he's been in team of the tournament, he won the tournament, we were to the games, every games. People were talking, we are not silly, people were trying to talk to us, and he say no. And I was like, oh, you know what?
How to do that?
Hey, Derek, I'm gonna tell you another things. The tournament was in my country, in France. He's French. He didn't come once to the stadium in five
No
games.
way.
Not even to the final. I was the captain of the team.
That's
How this
great.
can even, how this can even be possible? Then when we asked him, how can you do that? And he said, the games were on TV. I said, excuse me, your player is captain. And my dad was like, and I told him, and I say, my friends from my area where I grew up, right, were doing silly things, going five or six in the cars to come and support me, and you didn't come once to the game. And after that, I was like, no, there is some things, you know, at the time already, I was telling myself that football world, I don't like it that much. Because he was like, no, but the Nantes is very good. I say, it's nothing to do that Nantes is very good or not. You know, like, I need to know, did you see how I perform on the field? Imagine at the time, Derek, I know that Chelsea wanted me, Manu or so. Maybe it's a different life and career for me right now. You know? In terms of everything. And I say, you cannot play with somebody's life like that. So it's just, this was just, because you're giving me the possibility to talk about it. So I'm telling everything right now, you know, when it's with my country, you know, because I'm still playing. After people are like, oh, yeah, but is Jay lose because he didn't make it? No, it's nothing to do with that. I'm still very proud of who I am and what I've been doing, you know, because if two people can put my football boots and have the journey that I had with the number of times that I've been down to get back up, I would take them about because believe me, I'm still in touch with people that I met at Hibs and they're like, man, you're still playing, you're there, and next year you're there. And I can follow their career. And then, you know, they went from Hibs to other teams, but that way, you know what I mean? And I was like, but guys, you could have made a career. Look, me, you're phoning me tomorrow. Oh, I've got some things for you in China. Would you? Was the how many years the money blah blah blah. I'm in, you know, because this is I started this as a young age. We talk about it at the beginning for this, you know. It's not because somebody's closing a door on me that I'm now football is finished. No chance. I love this too much. I know that on earth somebody's gonna be thinking this guy is a good player. I want him in my squad, you know. That's why I've been doing all of that. And people sometimes, oh, are you not tired? Of course, I'm tired of traveling every day. And thankfully, it's my second year in the room, you know, because now there is the wife, the princesses, you know what I mean? You cannot well, ladies, let's go. We go there. We go. You know, my first one, she's gonna turn four.
Yeah.
She's born in Scotland. She lived in Malaysia.
Yeah.
She lived in USA. She's living in Lithuania. You know what I'm talking
that's,
about?
That's something else for a four-year-old. That's crazy.
You know, and it's crazy. Like, she's going to the international school here. She goes back home sometimes. She talked to us in Lithuania. We're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Lithuanian, we don't understand. Speak with your friends at school, but with us, it's English, French, or West Indian, but no Lithuanian, you know? It's crazy to have been, it's unfortunate for me to have been working with such an incompetent agent at the time. But it's like that. It's part of my life, I guess.
Yeah, there's some bad people in the game. Before you joined Hibs, you had a loan spell at Sedan. Did you learn much when you went there? Of course, you played some games for them.
Yeah, that experience has been, there was great things that I won't ever forget. I started my career over there. I played in League One. The top division, Ligue 1. So it was some things that I will take with me for good. But at the same time, I suffered a lot because I understand that being on loan in France, I'm not talking in general, is something that I wouldn't accept anymore.
Oh, really?
Because you're not the player, you're at the club, but you're not considered that a player of the club, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I get you. Yeah, not the same as actual contracted players.
You know,
yeah.
This is how I felt it, because
an outsider.
I went on loan there after 4 years of national team. I was actually in the pre-list of the under-21. In France, which is huge, you know, the names to be in under 21 at the time. And I was like, wow, it means that what I've been doing with the youth, you know, has been watching and stuff like that. And I was like, okay, if I play an amount of games, I'm going to go with the under 21. The first 15 games, not even in the squad.
Wow.
You got a guy on loan. And I wasn't even making the squad.
Yeah.
And I was like, what is the point here? You know,
yeah.
Try to speak with the coach. And I'm that type of guy. For me, talking with a coach, no. It's where I'm from, there is no need, Derek.
Yeah.
You talk on the field from Monday till Friday, you know?
Yeah.
And the first coach got the sacked. The assistant coach took over. I went. I was like, coach, please let me know what should I do to at least be on the squad. And he told me, Steven, you've got everything. Just realize that you've been playing to places before and it's not the same here, right? So there is things that you are doing that maybe people here is not going to understand. And if we concede a goal, the press is going to go against you. So just change these few things, which was you love those 20 meters pass between the lines, the football and stuff like that, you know? It was like, take this off, get the ball, 5 meters pass, you've done your job. He was like, do this. This was on a Monday, Derek, I swear. Monday to Friday, new Steven, get the ball 5 meters, this, that. I was frustrated because this is not my game, you know?
Yeah.
Friday, the list. I was on the list. We went to Nice. Somebody got injured. I was like, it's okay. I'm not going to get in. It's fine. You know, there is this guy, he's 32, blah, blah, blah. He says, Steven, Johan, go to warm up, blah, blah. Then, you know, when you're hearing your name, but you're like, no, I must be dreaming. And then Steven, then I can ask, yeah, come. Like, oh, it's happening. You know, I'm going to make my debut. And 2-3 words, do the same as training. That's it. Play. Got on really well. We drew over there 2-all. Next week, put me in the starting 11, yeah. 19. You say, why do you think you're going to start? And then, you know, it's quite an awkward discussion with the coach. You know, I was like, yeah. I think I did well. He was like, no, don't think. You did well, you know. And he said the same. Play your games and stuff like that. Amazing games the following day. We lost 1-0, but I did well. Everybody, newspaper and everything. And I was playing actually already my game, getting the balls in the hands of the goalkeeper, driving, blah, 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 pass 20 meters and stuff. But the ball were getting there, you know, because I was like, oh, if I die, let me die with my games, you know. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And following week, I told my dad after that game, that's me, you know, my career started. And then my dad looked at me in a funny way and I was like, what does he mean? I don't know if he had the feeling, you know.
Yeah.
Following week, we're going to Lorient. On Friday, yeah, the coach wants to talk to you. And yeah, Steven, before you get on at Nice, the guy who was playing got injured, blah, blah, blah. So tomorrow you're going to go back on the bench. And I don't know if I wanted to tell him or if I did tell him. So how should I suppose make my career start properly? If when I had my chance and I did well, and the guy's coming back and I'm the one who's going back to the bench. You know, the way I think, I was like, so I could have been terrible. It would not have changed anything.
Yeah.
You know? And he was like, I know. And then at the same time, he's the guy who gave me my chance. So I was like, okay. Then I played again against Nancy. I got on at halftime. And after that, the following, I played against Nancy, did well. Not as well as the first two games, to be honest. But okay, no goals conceded because of me, blah, blah, blah. Following week, it was the French Cup. And I was like, oh, that's good. He's going to take me and I'm going to play. Not even in the squad. And at that moment of time, once more, I told myself, never in my career again, I'm gonna be on loan. Never.
Yeah.
I said never. And after that, it was the bad thing started. Not in the squad. They sent me to train with the reserve team. It was crazy. I've been through a lot, Derek. I've been through a lot.
Even at just a young age.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why you know, many people are like, but how can you manage? You're always like, geez. And I say, hey, if you fail at age 18, 19, the way I did, with where I was coming from, everything talking about my names, being the next guy who's going to be national team, the main one, captain and everything, believe me that if you're not strong enough and clever enough, because you have to be clever also to take it to the chin and be like, well, there is two solutions. First one, I give up, I quit, and I make all of this guy happy. Second one, okay, it's going to be painful. It's not going to be the career I was thinking and working off, because I wasn't dreaming. It wasn't a dream, because I had everything to get that career, you know?
Yeah.
The rest of my colleagues made it. We were at the same national team for 4 years. Why they did and why I didn't. You know what I mean? That's why sometimes I want to tell people, few people in football, ah, if he was that good, he would have. I'm like, if you're going that way, if you're going that way, but let me tell you some things. There is people that are not coming out the academy, and they were way better than the guys that you can see from the same age from the academy.
Yeah.
Don't ask me why. Don't ask me how. It's happening. It's like that.
Yeah.
And I understood that a football coach is making your whole career. That you like it or not, this is the actual fact.
Yeah.
And that's it. But my friends and ex-teammates are like, you're still playing. I'm quite like in my country because I'm an inspiration. You know, the young guys are messaging me on social media. They can see my work ethic and stuff like that. People that I played against when I was young are messaging me. We're so sorry for you, Steven. You meant to be there with them, but you're still playing. You're still... And I'm like, yeah, you know, and I'm going to try to keep that until age 40 plus. I love to say that to people and they're like, no, you're crazy. And I'm like, no, I'm going to try to push this, you know, until forever, if I can say that like that, because it's so good to play football, Derek. Honestly, like, it's getting up in the morning and go and I'm 34, but it's still the same me. If I lose a five-sided game, oh, you're going to hurt me for 10, 15 minutes. And, you know, and some people, but get on with it. No, how can you say that? You know what I mean? And I told my coach and my wife, if one day I get home after a defeat and I'm not mourning, you can tell yourself it's done, you know?
Well, but, you're a long time retired, so you're as well trying to play as long as possible, Stephen. That's the thing. So that's a good attitude to have.
Yeah.